Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our worship service for Sovereign Grace Community Church for the last Sunday of September. And as we come and observe the changing of the seasons, we always remember the goodness of God to prepare seasons for life and for growth and for remission, and then to bring it about again the next year for the continuance of the life of His people. He has prepared the earth for our dwelling place, and He has prepared us so that we might worship Him. And that is our purpose, and we come together every week to worship and praise our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and God the Father, who has purposed all these things to come to pass. And so, if you'll stand and join with me, we can read from our call to worship, which is from Psalm 99, verses 1 through 5.
The Lord reigns, let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion. He is exalted over all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name. Holy is He. The King in His might loves justice. You have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Exalt the Lord our God. Worship at His footstool. Holy is He.
Indeed, we come before you this morning to worship you, to declare your worth, your glory, your honor, to speak of your name, to speak of your character, and that which is honoring to you. We thank you for blessing us and bringing us to this place, for the beginning of a new week, for the promises and for the plans that you have ordained from before the foundations of the world, that we would walk in them. And so we pray this morning as we come before you. We are coming before a holy God, that we have a sense of reverence before you, aware of your sovereignty, aware of your power, aware of your presence with us in this place. We come with that sense of worship, but also with a sense of joyfulness, for we know that in Christ our sins have been forgiven. For in Christ we have had washed, we've been washed in the blood. And we now have a righteousness declared to be ours, which makes us your children, that we can call you our Father. And so today we pray that you would bless us as we worship you, that our hearts and our thoughts would be that which is honoring to you through the word, as we think upon you, meditate upon you, experience your presence today, rejoice in Jesus, our Lord and Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen. Amen. And we can be seated.
Word of God across the ages comes the message to our hearts, source of hope forever present in our toil and fears and strife.
Morning scripture reading is from the second letter of Paul to Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 3, beginning with verse 1. But know this, hard times will come in the last days, for people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, boastful, proud, demeaning, disobedient to parents, ungrateful, unholy, unloving, irreconcilable, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, without love for what is good, traitors, reckless, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, holding to the form of godliness but denying its power. Avoid these people. For among them are those who worm their way into households and deceive gullible women overwhelmed by sin and led astray by a variety of passions, always learning and never able to come to a knowledge of the truth. Just as Jannes and Jambres resisted Moses, so these also resist the truth. They are men who are corrupt in mind and worthless in regard to the faith. But they will not make further progress, for their foolishness will be clear to all, as was the foolishness of Jannes and Jambres. But you have followed my teaching, conduct, purpose, faith, patience, love, and endurance, along with the persecutions and sufferings that came to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra. What persecutions I endured! And yet the Lord rescued me from them all. In fact, all who want to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Evil people and impostors will become worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and firmly believed. You know those who taught you, and you know that from infancy you have known the sacred scriptures, which are able to give you wisdom for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is inspired by God, and is profitable for teaching, for rebuking, for correcting, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. Amen.
Amen.
Indeed, it is a good thing to know that God watches over us, and that he understands we're going into days of difficulty and struggle, and yet he is faithful and watching over us. Well, welcome. We're glad you can be here together this morning. We're glad for those who are watching by the video we have, and pray that God is blessing your life and that you will also be able to worship him in spirit and in truth as we are doing here this morning in person. A couple of announcements we want to be aware of. One is that we did finish the voting for the hymns. We do have a list of the top 10 hymns, and that in the course of time we will find the way to best be able to do that. Maybe have a hymn sing, maybe do the top 10 one Sunday. We'll find out a way to be able to do that, but we're keeping it all under wraps until that time comes. So you just have to wait and lead up with anticipation for what's going to take place. Also, we're going to be going into the month of October. There's a lot of events that will be taking place. We'll be doing the annual OCC, the Operation Christmas Child Kickoff in October. So we hope that that's going to be something we'll begin. That's hard to believe is coming up again Just seemed like it happened last year. So so we'll be doing that once more. Also, we will have Reformation Day rally at the end of the month. We'll be co-sponsoring that with the Trinity Orthodox Presbyterian Church. We're very honored to do this. We've been doing it now for almost 30 years that we have worked together to be able to bring the witness of God's truth into the community. And so we have a speaker that's coming, and there's information on the back table, the information table. There's little handouts, so you'll want to get one of those and post it or be able to put it onto your phone, on your calendar, so you won't forget. That's the 27th of October. We also will be celebrating our 14th anniversary in October. Can hardly believe 10 years that we've been 14 years. Sovereign Grace Community Church started at 10-10-10, and God has been faithful to keep us going, small sometimes, but resilient nonetheless. And we've gone through times where others have faltered in some churches, and some ceased to exist, but God has been faithful to us as well. New directories are here if you need to get a new directory. And then also there's some material, reading material out there on the front. So those are some of the announcements. I do want to make a public announcement. I do want to appreciate the work that our elders did, Elder Randy and Elder Joseph, getting all the things from Valley Orchard out of there. So everything that we have ever owned at Valley Orchard is now up and gone and out. And I want to publicly thank them for the work that they did to get all that taken care of as well. So, and then another announcement is, some of you notice as you look around that the school is getting ready for a walkathon. That's a fundraiser that they have. And you notice that there are some shirts that they have available here. This is for like a TKer. they have all sorts of different sizes. And I'm not advertising the shirt. I'm just simply want to show you that we have believed, in order to help the education process, that our church has made a donation as one of the sponsors of the walkathon. And if you turn the shirt over, you will see that the very first listing on this shirt is Sovereign Grace Community Church. So we got top billing of all the sponsors, and there are a number, there's almost like maybe 20 or more sponsors here, and that ours is up at the top. So maybe, I'm thinking maybe that they want, that I knew somebody who knows somebody. I'm not sure what that is, but I think maybe they might have done that just as an opportunity to say thank you for us as well for all that we've been doing. So this coming Friday, there will be almost 200 shirts that are going to be worn. The walkathon is this Friday. 200 shirts will be worn, and every one of them will see Sovereign Grace Community Church on the front, on the top of that list. So, yeah, on the back side, on the top of that list. So I just thought that was kind of a thing to be reminded of God's goodness in all that he does and how he watches over our church and keeps us safe and keeps the witness there as well. So I do want to take the few moments now to spend time in prayer. We have a couple of concerns. Dean did go ahead and leave to go back to Nashville, and we need to pray for him as he gets settled, begins his treatments, and pray that God would be gracious to them and that the treatments would become successful and that he'll be returning sometime in November. So we want to pray for that as well. So we want to be able to keep Dean lifted up in our prayers. And also, Noah's birthday will probably be sometime this week. Noah, and the fact they're not here yet, maybe it may be today. We don't know, but they will. We need to keep that, to keep Maria and Hugo and family in prayer. She sent me a text saying that they be still good and healthy, but if it's not born by Friday, they're going to induce labor. So we'll let people know what's going to happen by Friday. Apparently, he wants to be an October baby and not a September baby. So, but we want to pray for them and their family. Appreciate the work, as with all the families that we have involved here. So also being praying for one another, maybe praying also that God is working in your heart and wanting to, there's things in your life that you need to bring before the Lord. Maybe it's a situation, a sense of thanksgiving before God. Maybe there's something that is on your mind, something that you need to bring. And as we do from week to week, we take just a few moments to quietly pray that we might seek the Lord and pray to him. And then I'll lead us in a moment of prayer afterwards. So let's together as God's people, let's go to prayer. O most holy and merciful Heavenly Father, we are grateful for this day of worship, grateful already for the hymns of joy that we were able to sing, thankful for your word spoken as it touched our hearts, and as you've moved by the power through the work of the Holy Spirit to bring your word into our lives. Today, Lord, we thank you for this time of worship. We thank you for the opportunity that you've given to us that we might declare your praise, that we might declare your worth. You are holy. You are gracious. You are good. You are merciful. You are love. And we thank you for that incredible love demonstrated to us through Jesus Christ, your Son. And Jesus, we thank you for your work of salvation for us, for your coming to earth, for your dying on the cross to save us from our sins, for the great resurrection by which we know that you have justified our lives and that we now stand fully forgiven before the Father. And Jesus, we thank you that you are now ascended and enthroned on high, ruling and reigning as sovereign. You are the one that is in control of all things. Lord, we see the chaos. We see the anger. We see division and disharmony throughout this world. We see man's inhumanity to man. We see sin and wickedness ruling the day. We see evil conquering good in so many places. And we see, Lord, things from our perspective as out of control and unprofitable. And yet you are sovereign. And there isn't a single thing that has come to pass that you have not ordained to come to pass that has purpose and significance in your great plan of your amazing grace. And so, Lord, we look to you in ways we can't even understand. We look to you for purposes we cannot fathom. We look to you for reasons why things happen the way they do. Lord, from our perspective, we feel as if you've abandoned us at times. We feel that you're far away from us. And yet your promise is that you will never leave us and you will never forsake us. So, Lord, when we are discouraged, when we go through difficulties, when we see the Christian community rocked by sin, that we know that you are still sovereign. And we know that your church still stands. And we know that your church will stand until the end of the ages, until you return again. And on that day, there will be a day of great victory when we will celebrate the reality of what we have by faith, that we will see by sight what we see with the eyes of faith. And we praise you for that day, and we thank you for that. We thank you for the power that you have sent to us through the work of the Holy Spirit, for his work of grace in our lives to sanctify us, to weed out the sin, to draw us to yourself. We thank you for his work. We are amazed at a triune God that would so love us as rebellious children. And yet you do. Amazing grace, amazing love, amazing mercy. May we never take lightly your great salvation plan for us. And we pray, O Lord, for our world. And we pray, O Lord, for many people to come to saving faith. And we pray, O Lord, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, this morning we also pray that you'd be with the life of our church. I thank you, Lord, for the ministry that you've given to us, for the years of service before you, seeing people come into the church and grow and then sent out to other places. We thank you, Lord, that you have kept us safe and you have endured and you've provided the resources for us to be where we are at this time, at this place. And we thank you that we have such a place as this even to worship. And we pray for this school, Lord. I pray for Harvest Christian School, for the witness of your teaching that goes on, that not only children are receiving education, but they're receiving it in a classical Christian setting. They're receiving it in a way that exalts Jesus Christ. And we pray for the children and the teachers and the staff, and we thank you for the connection that we have with them and the working together to accomplish this purpose in this time and place. And then, Lord, I pray that you would be with each one of us this morning. Be with Dean as he is back east, as he is beginning in the treatment plan for his life. We pray, Lord, that the treatment would accomplish what he desires. We pray, oh Lord, for your healing of his life. We pray that you would return him back to us, Lord, and that he would be healed of the issues that he is dealing with right now. Lord, we pray for our church families, for the children. I thank you for those who work with the children, Lord, for those who give of their time, their effort. Lord, I pray that you would reward them with great reward, that you would bless them as they are encouraging the children to walk in your ways. We pray even, O Lord, this morning for Noah. Lord, you know his birthday, and we pray, O Lord, that it would happen in a successful and joyful way, and that their family would rejoice and we could rejoice with them when we see a new life coming into this world. Lord, bless all that we do in our life of our church. Guide us, Lord, for the days that are ahead, that what we do will be not busy work, but kingdom work, that would honor and glorify your name, and that together we would grow in grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, Lord, bless your church. Bless each one of us. Guide us by your grace and for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Long preserved for our walk in They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart words of life, words of hope. Give us strength, help us cope in this world wherever we roam. Ancient words will guide us home. Ancient words, ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Holy words of our faith, handed down to this age, came to us through sacrifice. Oh, heed the faithful words of Christ. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words, ever true, changing me.
This morning, we're going to be shifting our direction of messages for the next few weeks. At the end of next month, of course, will be Reformation Sunday, which is a time that we have to celebrate God's truths. And these are which define God's people and which define our spiritual and historical heritage. So we're going to look at these next few weeks on these different themes of what it means to be reformed. There are two really true major events in the life of God's church that really define God's church. One was the New Testament, where the church was established, and the other was the 16th century Protestant Reformation. One established and the other reclaimed the foundations and the teachings of Christ's church. And there were those who were designed and committed to seeing that the church would be Bible-based, Christ-focused, Spirit-filled. And in this 16th century Protestant movement, there were people like Luther and Calvin and Zwingli and Lady Jane Grey and others that were used by the Lord to ensure that not even the gates of hell would prevail against his church. These that we speak of are timeless truths, exalting Jesus Christ, and that by the work of the Holy Spirit, they were received, they were fought for, people gave their lives for it, and have been cherished. We refer to them as the five solas. The word sola means alone, only. And we talk about sola scriptura, sola fide, sola gratia, solus Christus, and soli Deo Gloria. The Bible alone, grace alone, faith alone, Christ alone, the glory of God alone. These are the things we hold on to. These are those which define God's truth amid massive human error and deceit. These are the five truths which should be the foundation for every church that professes Jesus Christ. But sadly, they're not. These are the truths, these foundational truths, are those that we have endeavored to build Sovereign Grace Community Church and do this as a way to proclaim Christ, to teach and proclaim the gospel, and to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. These five foundational truths. So we're going to take a look at these. Every once in a while, if you build a house or you look at a house, you need to check the foundation. Every once in a while, I need to check to make sure that everything is in place and that we haven't shifted or moved. It's a time to rejoice in our worship. It's a time to look at Christ and to glorify and to magnify Him and have a time for evaluation of what we stand for. So often churches, the word doctrine is a four-letter word. It's something you just don't talk about. We don't want to be doctrine. We just want to be Jesus. But even if you say Jesus, you're saying doctrine. So I want us to understand, I want us to get a clear understanding of what our church stands for and what the truths are about God's truth. And so today, as you can see already, we're beginning with the idea of sola scriptura, the Bible alone, the only source for our truth and sanctification. It is the only message that we have. Even the reformers began here, looking at God's word. Now you would think that saying sola scriptura would be kind of a no-brainer for a church, right? I mean, after all, what church wouldn't say the Bible only? Well, you would be surprised. Ran across the most recent Gallup poll statistics, and according to what they have come up with, they asked three questions. How many people believe that the actual is God's actual word and should be taken literally? Others, the second question was, how many believe it is inspired word, but you can't take all of it literally? And how many believe it to be fables and made up stories? Well, the number of people that actually believe the word of God is and to be taken literally, that is a literal six-day creation, a literal flood, a literal resurrection of the dead of Jesus Christ, and so on, of all people in the United States, 20%. It does get better among Christians. It moves up to 25%. And among evangelicals, it really jumps to 40%. 40% of the evangelical church in the United States believes that this is actually God's word and we are to take it literally. 40%. So how about inspired word, but you can't take it all truly. You can't take everything literally. In other words, you can't take a 6 day. That's science proves that that's not true. Well, of all people, 49% of all in the United States believe that. It goes to 58% of all Christians, and 51% of evangelicals. So it drops a little bit. If there's any good news in this thing, that would probably be the place it would go to. Mm-hmm. How about fables? In fables, 29% of all Americans believe the Bible is just made up stories. They're fables. Jonah wasn't really swallowed by a big fish. There was not a creation, all those sorts of things. Among Christians, that drops to 16%. And among evangelicals, 8% believe the Bible to be fable. After I read that, I thought, we need to talk about the Bible. We need to talk about this because oftentimes we're not in the majority of opinion when it comes to the Word of God. We're in a time when we can't describe the Word of God as an absolute, because in society, there are no absolutes. And they're absolutely sure there are no absolutes. which kind of tends to focus on their inconsistency in thinking. And even we have now begun to see a movement of anti-Christian, anti-Bible. The Bible doesn't say what it means. And by the way, that's a 2,000-year-old Bible. That's a 2,000-year-old book. We wouldn't go to the doctor and expect him to pull out a book 2,000 years old for medical treatment. So why would we expect that to be for our life? We've passed beyond that time. God just simply talks to us, and we wait for God to talk, and we do whatever we feel like God is saying to us. There's such a movement away from the truth, from the Word, from Christian teaching. And yet it is into this time and this place that we have been called to be faithful witnesses to Jesus Christ. That we've been called to be a church that is Bible-believing, Christ-honoring, and Spirit-filled. So how do we do this? We go back to the foundations. And that's what I want us to look at. And I want to look at the idea of sola scriptura, the Bible alone. The idea of sola scriptura, technically, it is a Christian theological doctrine that teaches the Bible as the sole infallible source for authority for Christian faith and practice. It asserts that the Bible alone should be treated as the ultimate and most trustworthy authority in all matters of faith, doctrine, and Christian living. The Bible alone. The reformers of the 16th century faced a huge backlash. For the church that was popular at that time taught that the Bible is one source of truth, the Pope is another source of truth, the council and the councils and their edicts are another source of truth, and so you have all three together. They would not deny the Bible. You see, the great issue of the Reformation is not the truths that were presented, it's that little word that stuck on in their craw. It was sola. Only. To say the Bible alone, the Bible only, was to make a profound, radical statement to them, and I think it makes a profound, radical statement to us today. If we tell people that we're a people of the Bible, that we believe that God speaks to us through the Bible, and if we want to hear God's word to us today, we read the Bible out loud. And yet, that's not seen as a popular thing. Even our own Confession of Faith, the Second London Confession of Faith of 1689, of which we have seen and we hold on to as in principle truth, it says this about God's Word. It says, the Holy Scripture is the only sufficient, certain, and infallible rule for all saving knowledge, faith, and obedience. And it is the one that has wisdom and power so as to leave men inexcusable. The authority of the Holy Scriptures, for which it ought to believe, depends not upon the testimony of any man or church, but wholly upon God. And so we believe, there are 10 paragraphs here of what we believe, what we hold to as the authority of the Bible. That I trust that we are a people of the Bible. Now I may be preaching to the choir today. I may be doing preventative message today, but I want you to take the time to evaluate what role, what place does the Bible actually have in your day-to-day living. We are a people to be known as the Word. In fact, even our logo, if you look at the outline there, we see the logo, which is taken from 2 Peter, which reminds us that we are up of the foundation holding up God's truth in this world. I'm sorry, 1 Timothy 3:15. That's what we say we are. We say we're a people of the Bible. We focus attention on the fact that we call the sacred desk. This is kind of like a mini desk, but the sacred place where God's word is preached has been positioned in the middle and not off to the side. Ever been to a church or a place where the pulpit's off to the side, where the table takes center place? The Reformers believe, rightly so, that it is the Word of God that takes center place in worship. And that is part of worship, the teaching and the reading of God's Word. Someone once said, well, you know, if you preach longer, then we have less time to worship. Well, no, preaching is worship. Preaching is part of what goes on. And so we have this, that is our significance. But my fear is we're doing it in a rote manner. That's what might be, not that it's happening, but the fear would be that we just become cavalier about it, that we just take it for granted, and yet we do not understand nor appreciate the Word of God for what it is. The Word of God is our only source for salvation. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Jesus prayed for our sanctification in John 17 when he said, sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. If you're trying to grow as a Christian life and you don't have the Bible as a part of your life, you're not going to get very far. Certainly, you're not going to have the sanction of Christ or the Holy Spirit to enable that to take place. Paul, when he was talking to the church before he left at Ephesus, said, and now I commend to you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. Paul saw that when he was leaving the church, what was he entrusting to them? The word of grace. And Peter tells us that all flesh is like grass. We see that happening, don't we, in society? Somebody passes away. Names that we've thought were part of the significance of our life, after a few years, we don't even remember them any longer. All flesh is like grass. When I graduated from Cal Baptist, I'm calling it university now, even though it was a college then, I thought that perhaps maybe my attitude, I thought I had a better attitude. The attitude I guess I was exuding was, after I leave, the place ought to shut down. There's nothing else that can happen. Once I'm gone, what good could come of that college? And one of the professor's wives, who I worked for in the library, said, Kevin, if you ever know how much you're missed, get a bucket of water, fill it right to the top, put your hand in the water, leave it there for 30 seconds or more, and then take it out and see what kind of impression it leaves. She said, we'll be fine. And apparently they are. They've grown from 800 to 12,000 people. But all flesh is, and this is what Peter is saying, all flesh is like grass, and its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers, the flower fades. But what is it that remains forever? The Word of God. So how do we carry this out? What is the best way that we're able to profit, to be able to take advantage, to be able to glorify, love, and live for Christ using his word? How do we best do this? I know there are a lot of people who say, well, you know, I read the Bible once, but it really didn't do anything for me. But we need to remember that God has not only revealed his word to us, but in his word, he has revealed to us the way in which we can best utilize his word. And that's what I want to think about today. That's what I want to focus our attention on today. Not so much all the what it says, but how do we take advantage of God's word? How do we use it to its best ability? How do we uncover this wealth of wisdom from the Word of God? I think Augustine at this point is a good help for us. He simply said, tole lege, which means pick it up and read it. The first thing you want to do is read it. But how can we profit from this? How do we get the most out of this? Let's read together. I want to turn to the Proverbs. When in doubt, go to the Proverbs. They're filled with wisdom. We've been reading in the Psalms of David and his instruction to his son. Proverbs is David's son, Solomon, instruction to his son. And he begins Proverbs in chapter 2 with the first 14 verses. And I'd like to work our way through this as a means of which how we can glean and gain the most from Bible reading. Do you ever read the Bible and after 15, 20 minutes, 5 minutes, 2 minutes of reading the Bible, you think, I didn't get anything out of that at all. I didn't know anything. Don't even know what I read, let alone know what it means. And let alone did I get something out of it that's going to help me tomorrow or the next day or the next week in life. Well, this is what I want to put our attention on. This is what Solomon addresses here in Proverbs. So Proverbs chapter 2, beginning with verse 1. It says this under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. My son, if you receive my words and treasure up my commands with you, making your ear attentive to wisdom and inclining your heart to understanding, yes, if you call out for insight and raise your voice for understanding, if you seek it like silver and search for it as for hidden treasures, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom, from his mouth comes knowledge and understanding. He stores up sound wisdom for the upright. He is a shield to those who walk in integrity, guiding the paths of justice and watching over the way of his saints. Then you will understand righteousness and justice and equity, every good path. For wisdom will come into your heart, and knowledge will be pleasant to your soul. Discretion will watch over you. Understanding will guard you, delivering you from the way of evil, from men of perverted speech, who forsake the paths of uprightness to walk in the ways of darkness, who rejoice in doing evil and delight in the perversion of evil, men whose paths are crooked, and those who are devious in their ways. How do we avoid? How do we deal with this? The concept around all of this, one word that stands out, this is really the setting of all of the book of Proverbs. This kind of sets the table for everything else in Proverbs, and certainly it expands out to everything in the Bible. The concept is wisdom. And ultimately, this wisdom is to be found in Jesus Christ. Peter tells us in 2 Peter chapter 1, everything is necessary for life and godliness is found in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. So we see this as the wisdom that comes from Christ. And this is what we're going to be focusing on. This gives us several ways, three ways I want to identify of how we encounter and deal with God's word. It is in an if-then fashion. Do you see that? Verse 1, if this certain things happen, if you call out, if you seek it. And then verse 5 gives us the other part, then. If you do this, then this is what will happen in verse 5. And then later on, verse 9 says the same thing, then. So there's if you do certain things, then you can expect that there's going to be certain responses that will take place because of what you did under the if part. And actually, if anybody wants to diagram this sentence, we think Paul is bad. Proverbs chapter 2, verses 1 all the way through verse 11 is one sentence. One sentence. Try finding the main verb in that one. One sentence. It just goes on and it goes on and goes on and goes on. It's covered. And it's like Solomon, once he gets started, he just can't stop. He's got to give this full picture of what it means to be a people of God's word. It is a picture of Christ. We see words like insight, or words like the word of God, the commandments of God, the wisdom of God, the insights of God, the understanding of God, things that we would like to have for our life, things that we would like to say, I have a way through this. I understand this. I get this. So how is it then that we are able to get the most out of God's word? Three things I think that we can relate to here. Three things I want us to be able to focus on. One is that there, in order for us to gain the wealth of wisdom, the first is there needs to be an effort exerted. There needs to be an effort exerted. All of that was introduction. Now we're on the outline here. An effort exerted. if you do certain things. And notice he is writing this in a father-son. It's not a preaching. It's not a teaching, formal teaching. It is a relationship of conveying from one generation to the next generation. That can be literally from a father to their children. It can also be spiritually, from a spiritual father to spiritual children. It is the reading, the studying, and the applying of God's word with effort. We just can't kind of bounce in and out of the Bible. It is a discipline. You go to the gym, you just don't expect to get the most out of the gym by just going and pulling that weight occasionally and then doing this occasionally and doing the other thing and back and forth and flitting around from all the... No, it's a discipline. It's an ongoing thing, whether we're learning skills or abilities or growing in whatever way. It is a discipline, and God's word is a discipline here. I don't see him saying, now, my son, go to sleep tonight with the Bible under your pillow, and when you wake up, your mind will be full of the Bible. That's not what he's saying here. He is making the point that the study to get the most out of the Bible requires effort. It's effort exerted. And there are three things he tells us here. He says, first of all, there is a personal application. He says, if you receive, and then if you treasure. Those are two aspects of this personal application. If you receive, that's not a passive thing, like I receive a text on my phone, or I received a phone call from my doctor, or I received a bill from PG&E in the mail, and then call the doctor. This is not a passive term. This is an active effort exerted. It is a strong word. It means if you receive, it means to take, to grasp, to hold, to seize. Even the old word of to fetch. It's even used in the Old Testament to take a wife. You receive. It exerts energy and effort. It is deliberate. It's not a pick a verse kind of thing we're talking about here. God is teaching us in this word, if you receive my words. This implies that we must be willing, ready, and able, enabled by the Spirit of God, to grasp God's word. And it conveys the sense of receiving the instruction with a favorable mind. I'm not reading the Bible to see where it's wrong. I'm not reading the Bible to find its mistakes. I am reading the Bible because I know that God gives to me what he has in his word, and I want to receive it. And I want to go after it. And I want it to be a personal application. Someone said, what you are as a Christian is what you are when you are with God and nobody else. Because he knows the truth of your heart. So Solomon is instructing us, if you receive my words. And how do we receive them? We receive them making your ear attentive and your heart ready. Inclining your heart, using your ears and inclining your heart. Outwardly making your ears attentive, and inwardly inclining your heart, stretching the heart. The idea here is you don't read the Bible, it goes in one ear and not the other. But to hear and to heed. Here, a hearing heart describes an obedient heart, which is underscored by this parallelism with the heart. Making your ear attentive, it says in verse 2, making your heart inclined. So that's the first thing we do is you receive. The second personal application is you treasure it. The word treasure here means primarily to hide, to keep secret, to conceal, to value something, to protect something, to hold something in a precious state of conditions here. It can be used as a dowry for a bride or the wise words of a father. In short, when we treasure God's word, what it is encouraging us to do is to memorize it. David said the same thing. Thy word have I hid, same word as treasured, in my heart that I may not sin against you. Mary, when she was in the middle of all that was going on, treasured these things and pondered them in her heart. You treasure it. You see what it is, and you want to hide it in your heart. This is what the proverb is telling us, that we are to receive it, and we are also to treasure it. And to treasure it for the right reason. The right reason is to know Jesus. You see, that was the problem of the Pharisees in Jesus' day. In fact, in John 5:38, Jesus accused the Pharisees by saying this, "You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life." Okay, noble cause, you want to do that. "And it is they that bear witness about me," Jesus says, "yet you refuse to come to me that you may have life." The idea of the effort that needs to be exerted. It is a personal application. The second thing in this effort that we need to see is a prayerful appeal. At the same time that we are to put effort into this, there's also the need for a prayerful appeal. Verse 3, "If you call out for insight and you raise your voice for understanding." I have a group of 6th graders and 7th graders and 8th graders. And if I'm saying something and they don't get it, boom, immediately the hand goes up. They're crying out, "I don't get this." Or if I'm teaching math to 6th graders, they're saying, "I don't understand this problem. Can you help me figure this out? I got it wrong. I need help. Help me understand what's going on." That's what's at the heart here. Because we can't understand God's word unless God gives us the understanding for that word. And so that's what he's talking about. This is teaching us that apart from the sovereign work of the Lord, we can't gain any profit from it. If we expect to read it to find some quick answer, and we just dive into this without a humbleness, without an idea of saying, "Lord, teach me what you have for me today." That we always should come before the word of God with prayer, with a crying out. He says, "Cry out for insight." After he said in verses 1 and 2, "Go after it like a dog with a bone," then he says, oh yeah, pray. Prayer. Seek God, apart from which there is no understanding of God's word. Spurgeon says this, "It is remarkable that this person does not pray for understanding through acquiring knowledge, but begs of the Lord first that they may have the gracious gift of understanding, and then they may obtain the desired instruction." I don't read this for understanding. I pray, "Lord, give me understanding as I read it." And so that's what Solomon is teaching here. It is a prayerful appeal. This appeal to God for guidance for your life, because apart from him, you don't even have a clear picture of your life. We need somebody outside, objective, to be able to understand and see what our life is about. We're right in the middle of it. That's why you never ask a fish for the temperature of the water. They don't understand it. There's nothing outside of them to measure it against. We have a sinful way of thinking. Our thoughts tend to be toward evil and toward sin. And so we need to pray, "Lord, help me to have the insight. Help me to have the understanding that I might know your word, that I might understand your word." And so there is a prayerful appeal. It is a matter of humility and a desire to honor Christ. And what does he say in James? If any of you lack wisdom, have you ever been in a situation where you lack wisdom? Yeah, we all, I think, have at some point in time. What does James say? Ask God. Ask God. And then take it to the word. And then read the word. Prayerful appeal. So not only is there an effort that needs to be exerted, the personal application of that, but there's also a prayerful appeal that needs to be there. And the third thing is that we need to have, that Solomon tells us in verse 4, and that is to have it as a priceless assessment. Treasure it. He says, so if you receive it, that's personal application. If you cry out for it, that's the prayerful appeal. And if you seek it like silver and search for it as hidden treasures. I think I've told you the story that a number of years ago, there used to be a baseball team that played a baseball game in Rona Park. I guess it's pretty much where Costco is now. And they had one day called Digging the Diamond. And it was that they had, out in the infield in the diamond, they had several large or good-sized diamonds, real diamonds, in the infield, along with other little bits and pieces along the way. And you paid a price, and you went out there, and you dug for the diamond. And that was before the game started. And then, they redid the infield. But we were watching the people that had paid money to go out and do that. Now, do you think that they just casually walked out there? Do you think they just said, oh, let me see. Yeah, might be there. Nope, nothing there. Might be here. No, nothing there. Do you think it was a casual approach? No. They sprinted to the dirt. They had shovels and buckets, and they went crazy. Dirt was flying everywhere. They were searching. They were looking. They got dirty looking for a little trinket, maybe $10, $15, $20, maybe a $50 piece of jewelry or diamond, and I think the biggest prize is several $100 diamond. But they did it because they were looking for treasure. Now, I enjoy, don't do it often, but I enjoy panning for gold. Okay. Boy, I'm going to have to preach where nobody knows me, because you all know me too well at this point. I have been known to hold up a busload of people in downtown in pouring rain with the flooded conditions of the river, yelling out, just one more panful. Estimation. Why would I do that? Well, several people have ideas. But this gets the idea of what we are to do with God's word. It is a priceless assessment. We seek God's truth and God's word as you would seek for silver, as you would seek for a hidden treasure. Both of these terms, a comparison, pausing to think about, what does this mean? Do I approach Scripture and the desire to get from Scripture what God has to me? Am I desirous to get the wealth of wisdom from the Word of God in the same way I would go after diamonds or gold or treasure or silver? Do I have that intensity? Or do I say, I'll turn a page over here and see what I find, and I'll turn a page over here and see what I can find? We can't expect to gain the wealth of wisdom that God has for us if we take a haphazard approach to God's word. That's why he is saying there is the need for a priceless assessment and to seek for it. The word for seeking expresses a person's earnest seeking of something or someone with the intention that it will be found. It pictures one earnestly searching until the object is located. Do you ever lose your phone? Do you ever lose your car keys? You don't just simply say, well, they might be here. They might be over here. I'll get around to them sometime. No, you, if it's a phone, you're thinking, I've lost the phone, and I know that one message that the most important message I'll ever receive is on that phone, and I can't find the phone. Then you get to the point where you can't find your glasses until you find out that they're on your head. I mean, it goes on. But we have a sense of something that I have is lost. And stop everything. Nobody do anything. Help me search for what's missing. There is an intensity here. That's what Solomon is saying. We approach God's word with this intensity, knowing that the truth that comes from God's word is the wealth of wisdom with a priceless assessment. Ezra in order to be able to teach up. He, first of all, he read the word, he studied the word, and then he taught the word. So God is telling us that there needs to be an effort. If you have personal application, and if you have a prayerful appeal, and if you consider this to be a priceless assessment. Oh, then verse 5, then we get to the then, right? That's the second part. First part has to do with an effort exerted. The second part deals with the relationship encountered. The relationship that we encounter with God. Then means at that time. What time? At that time when we have carried out the seeking and the searching. And so in this exerted effort, what will you get? A body of information? Intellectual pride? The Bible tells us that vain wisdom puffs up a person. What do we expect to find when we see and we diligently do verses 1 through 4? What we find in verse 5 is the encounter with God. Not just a body of information, but we encounter the living God. If you do this, then you will understand, he says, several things here. There is a relationship that we're talking about here. There is a revelation from God that we're talking about here. And there is a righteousness that comes of God that we experience. You want to experience God in your life? Go to the Word. Put the energy, put the effort into reading God's Word. If you do that, then you will understand. Then you will experience the living God. The ways that we encounter God. There's a relationship with God defined in two ways. Then you will discern the fear of the Lord and you will find the knowledge of God. That's a relationship. The relationship with God begins with the fear of the Lord. How do you understand the fear of the Lord? You read the Bible. You discern the fear of the Lord. This means the ability to understand concepts and to see the relationships between them. The Hebrew word here for discern describes the faculties of comprehension, intelligence, acuteness, and shrewdness. We discern the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord, the Bible tells us, is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the place we go to. When you put energy into reading God's word, you experience God. What a concept. What an idea. The Reformers understood that. The Reformers said, you don't need an intermediate. You don't need a priest. You don't need a go-between. You don't need somebody else to take you to God. You don't need to pray to the saints or to Mary or anybody else to experience God. You can experience and encounter God directly by reading his word. And that's what Solomon is telling him. It is a fear of the Lord. It is interesting that this is exactly what Solomon prayed for. As a young man, he was going to inherit his father's kingdom. And he recognized, that he needed help. And so God said, okay, whatever it is, what do you need? And he could have prayed for riches. He could have prayed for all sorts of things. What he prayed for was for the wisdom that comes from God. And God blessed him with all the other things because of that. So Solomon understood wisdom and understood the fear of the Lord. The wisdom that we're looking at here, to understand the fear of the Lord, is a wisdom that is the ability to fear the Lord has to do with knowing him and knowing who he is and knowing where we stand with him. It is the ongoing relationship with Christ by the Holy Spirit. It enables us to view the situations and to carry out decisions pleasing to God and ultimately that which is beneficial. To have the mind of Christ begins with the fear of the Lord, which comes from the reading of his word and comes from the diligent application to his word. So he says the relationship is based on the fear of the Lord. But then he says, secondly, he says, then you will understand the fear of the Lord, and the other part of verse 9, and will find the knowledge of God. The knowledge implies the relationship of God with experience. The knowledge, knowing Adam and Eve knew one another and they had a child. It was an intimate knowledge, the same word that is here. You study the Bible not for facts, but for the Father. It is about knowing God and moved in your heart to love him. And these two are connected. The more you fear God, the more you know God, and the more you know God, the more you fear God. It all comes from the Bible. So reading the Bible isn't about getting smart. Reading the Bible is about getting saved and getting sanctified, of growing in your relationship. Where do you stand with the Lord right now? How does the study of your word encourage, enhance, and develop the capacity for you to understand the fear of the Lord and to know the knowledge of God? That's why he gave us the word. And that's what Solomon is saying to you. This is the then of the ifs, that you will find this. It is a relationship. The second thing, as we make it about a relationship, it is also about the revelation from God. There is a revelation from God. Because he says in verse 6, for the Lord gives wisdom. God delights to give us wisdom. God delights to give us the understanding. He has revealed himself to us in the person of Jesus Christ and given testimony to Christ in his word. The means is the word, but the source is God. Godly wisdom is wisdom that comes from God and honors God. Godly wisdom starts with the fear of God and results in a holy life. There is a revelation of God. God is revealed here. It says in verse 6, for the Lord gives wisdom, and from his mouth comes knowledge and understanding. He stores up sound wisdom for the upright. God is more desirous for you to have godly wisdom than you are to want to have it. And he's made every way possible for us to be able to obtain it. But we acknowledge it is from him. What a blessing it is. That's why the New Testament speaks the same thing. He says, let the word of Christ dwell richly in you, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom. Singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. Immersion in God's word produces a heart of worship and thanksgiving. And the heart of worship becomes the fertile soil for the seeds of wisdom to grow. Wisdom is not simply a means to an end. It is a relationship with the giver. I want to be wise, not in the knowledge of the Bible. I want to be wise in Christ. And how we do that is by obtaining this wisdom. If you do these things, then you will understand. For it is the Lord, verse 6 and verse 7, that does these things for you. And not only is there a revelation from God, but there's also a righteousness of God in verses 7 and 8. For he stores up sound wisdom for the upright. He is a storehouse of wisdom. What a blessing that is. You want to know how to live your life? You want to know how to be the right husband or wife? You want to know how to be the right child or parent? You want to know how to do all the things that God has called you to do? How do we in the world, we make it in this world when there's so many different things, so many different voices out there, so many different things taking place? We go to all sorts of things, books and podcasts and television shows and talk radio and all the kind of things. Where do we find the wisdom? How do we negotiate? He stores up sound wisdom for the upright. He grants the wisdom to know how to get through this world. There is a righteousness. The righteousness is a right living before God. And not only is he a storehouse, But it also tells us in verse 7, he is a shield. He is a shield. He is a shield to those who walk in integrity, guarding the paths of justice, verse 8, and watching over the ways of his saints. What a blessing that is. And how do we have the assurance of that? From the Word. We look at the Word. We read the Word. We study the Word. We gain from the Word these things. This is the relationship we have. We have a relationship with God. We have a revelation that comes from God. We have a righteousness of God. That's the second thing. The third thing, we'll move quickly through this, and that's beginning in verse 9. We see another then, don't we? Then. It's repeated from verse 5. It is the introduction of the if-then factor. It is the then of the if. If you do these things, verse 5, then there's certainly going to happen, this relational things. But then we're going to see in verses, beginning in verse 9, there is going to be a outcome experienced. That's the third part. An effort exerted, a relationship experienced, and an outcome experienced. The former outcome in verse 5 refers to the focus on God and our relationship with God that we have. This one appears to be more specifically how we live out our lives. The benefit of this, the benefit, the nature. What do we gain? What do we have? What is the wealth of wisdom that comes? And it's in three forms. There is, first of all, a life of discernment in verse 9. A life of discernment. Then you will understand. Then what? It goes back all the way to if. If you receive my words, if you call out for righteousness, if you seek it like silver or gold, then you will understand righteousness and justice and equity and every good path. A sense of discernment. The reality of understanding, grasping that which is right and good, and the reality of insight, recognizing the path of goodness. And so there is an outcome that's experienced of discernment. But more than that, in verse 10, there's also a life of delight. A life of delight. Verse 10. For wisdom will come into your heart, and knowledge will be pleasant to your soul. The joy of understanding God's ways. The joy that comes from Scripture. The joy that takes place when there's a delight in reading God's Word. We delight in God's Word. We value it. We know of the effect. We share in the wealth. When a person found that diamond, they're just a little bit happy.
Yeah.
When a person finds their phone, they're a little bit relieved. When they find the car keys, they can continue about what their activities are. When they find what they're looking for, there's a sense of relief and joy. Remember that Jesus talked about that with the lost coin and the lost sheep and the lost son. There is joy. And that's what he's talking about. That is the outcome. That's one thing that we can expect in this and experience this. When you're reading God's Word, as you devote to God's Word, you will have a life of delight. The wisdom will enter your heart. There will come a time when there will be wisdom and you grow in that wisdom. We always talk about if you do this, it'll happen. It happens. And I pray and I know that most of you, my heart is for all of you, have experienced that delight and that joy of understanding a way of God and letting it come into your life. There's a delight. This knowledge will be pleasant to your soul. So by putting yourself on the line, by saying, I have no other place of authority, I have no other place of knowledge other than God's Word, and I've made the effort, and I see the relationship, I experience then the outcome of a life of discernment. Boy, don't we need discernment in this day and age. I have a life of delight. And the last thing in verses 11, there is a life of deliverance. We are delivered. Discretion will watch over you. Understanding will guard you, delivering you from the way of evil, from the men of perverted speech who forsake the paths of righteousness. Well, we need a way through this world, don't we? We are so hounded by evil and evil ways and evil thinking and evil practices and godless approaches to life. We talk about what a minority it is for people who believe in God's word as the word of God. And so we seek for deliverance. Deliverance through discretion. Deliverance from evil. Rescued from those who speak perverse things. Rescued from those who have the ways of darkness. And then having the joy of those that you will be delivered from. That is the part we're looking at. That is the foundation of sola scriptura. It's not something on the side. It's a foundation. Therefore, the Bible teaches that you cannot have a superficial reading of the Bible and expect a great depth of joy in your life. This joy, this security, this foundation for a person, a family, a church, the Christian community, this is reserved for those who diligently seek, search, and study the Word. Because when we do that, we see Jesus. Sola Scriptura. We are committed to a church. And I know that. You get somebody else up here at this sacred desk, and they're not bringing you the Word of God, you wouldn't stand it for 2 minutes. You may be a little awkward how you're going to get the person off the stage, but you wouldn't stand it for 2 minutes. And I am so blessed to have a church that is so committed to God's Word. But we got to keep on keeping on, because times are going to get harder. And the idea of building our life, our church, our witness, our ministry, your life, on the truth of God's word alone, is going to be a time and a place where you can't stand on both sides of the shore. It either is or it isn't. This is the time to be committed. The reformers did that. Some of them were martyred for their faith. Others rejoiced to see great advancement in the kingdom of God. But whatever it was for the glory of God. And so we talk about sola scriptura, not to say we have it and you don't, nanner, nanner. But we say it because we believe it to be the way of truth that honors Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Lord, we are so grateful that you have given to us your word today, that you have blessed us with truth beyond measure, that we cannot ever fathom the fullness of the riches, the wealth that you have in your word. For your word teaches us of Jesus. And we thank you for our salvation in Jesus, for our sanctification in Jesus, and ultimately for our glorification in Jesus. Lord, in this day and age, we're shifting sands are moving away from the word. Help us, as you taught in your sermon, Jesus, that we are, in order to build our house on the rock, we must hear the word and do the word. And may we do this to your honor and glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Now let's stand as we sing our final song for the day.
Shout!
Lord, it is our desire as we leave from here that we would stand on your promises, the promises from your word, the promises that remind us of our salvation, of our sanctification, of our purpose and ministry in life. May you bless us as we go from day to day, as we remain and continue to grow to be a people of the word for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing on the promises. Standing on the promises. By standing on.